space for you. So we're really appreciative that you're here.
No, thank you for having me.
Yeah, thanks. So I wanted to start by just sharing a little bit of your story. I think you have a fascinating story of how you started. There are many that are watching right now that are entrepreneurs and are trying to find their niche, trying to find what they're good at. And it's not easy. It's not easy,
no.
Right? Yes. So can you share a little bit about your, I would say that, you know, the struggles that you had initially and how you discovered that this was actually a legitimate business?
Well, I think the most important thing is to start with something you love. And for me, one thing I love being creative and I love people. But I didn't really know what angle I was going to go or what field I was going to get into. Fortunately, I kind of stumbled across this particular business that I'm doing, and it kind of addressed the need I had, which was to be around people, to meet new people, to talk to people, and it allowed me to be creative. And I think that definitely any entrepreneur, when they start any kind of business, is going to encounter some roadblocks, and
right.
I definitely encountered mine. But if you're persistent enough and you're able to withstand all the rejection, because you're gonna get rejection.
Right.
And in the beginning, particularly in the first few years, I was rejected time and time again. For every yes, I received 100 no's. And you have to be okay with that. You have to be okay hearing no, I don't need this, no, I don't want this, no, I'm not gonna take a meeting. Because as you keep hearing the no's, you become a bit callous to it. And as long as you don't lose that drive, eventually you'll get a yes. And once you get your first yes, the second is a lot easier to come by.
Wow, that's interesting, because I do think that a lot of people who are starting out, that's the hardest part is, you know, once you get that, you know, door closed in your face, you just want to retreat and run the other direction.
Yeah.
Yes. When did you, you worked with, now being in this business, in this industry, you founded the business in 2002, correct?
Correct, yes.
And you came in as a force to be reckoned with. If you kind of saw the industry, and from what I've gathered and, you know, looking back at your journey, you can see that your vision for it was a bit different than the everyday jewelry store that you walk into, or, you know, that concept. Did you see a need to cater to a certain demographic that wasn't being filled?
Well, I started my business in Beverly Hills, naturally, and Beverly Hills happens to be the home of a lot of different celebrities. We've got a lot of professional athletes coming in and out, a lot of actors, actresses, and musicians. So I was very fortunate to probably start in the best city you can start at. So I had, celebrities were accessible. And if you're as persistent as I am and as aggressive as I am, I made sure I put myself in a position to meet as many celebrities and athletes as possible. And like I said, I never took no for an answer. But eventually, as time had gone on, I realized I was catering exclusively to the celebrity and athlete community. And I said to myself, these people have very unique tastes.
Right.
They have very specific tastes, but will the general public actually like this? That's when I decided I was going to venture off into opening traditional brick and mortar retail. I wanted to see if my eclectic designs, my eccentric designs, was something that the average person, the average luxury consumer would actually appreciate. And lo and behold, after we opened our first store, we realized that, like, we brought something different to the table. We brought a breath of fresh air to an industry that's been so stale for so long. And it was always my dream to make sure I'm treating each and every client like they are the same as a celebrity. If I see Jennifer Lopez, I want every client, whether they're spending $1,000 or $1 million, to have that same experience. And I think that's what we've been able to accomplish in each and every store. And, you know, we've been fortunate enough to open now in Japan, where we bring the celebrity experience even to our customers in Tokyo.
Right.
So I think this has been a great thing. I think our clients get a different experience than they do at other retail stores. And we've been able to deliver a product that doesn't look like anybody else's. And I always say, this is not your grandmother's jewelry. Because I remember being a kid looking through my grandmother's jewelry and saying, this is great, it's beautiful, but everybody's grandma has the same jewelry.
Right.
So I wanted to provide something different. It's not for everyone, it's for a small niche group of people, but I think that fact that I addressed that niche is what allowed us to become successful.
And you mentioned mention Jennifer Lopez. I know she's one of your clients among many others. You have Justin Bieber has purchased beautiful jewelry from you. Matthew McConaughey. I mean, the list goes on. This interview could be just about them, and we would just have, you know, an hour full of just your clients. But I know you also don't just cater to the celebrities. You also cater to international royalty and, of course, successful businessmen and things of that nature. But going back to the celebrity aspect, because I know people love to hear
that. They like to hear that,
yeah. That's a huge interest. But what would you say, looking back, is one of the, was the most challenging design concept that a celebrity came to you, one of, you know, and with it, with a concept, and you kind of had to, you know, blow that up into something or attract their concept and then create it into a vision?
Well, you know, an interesting story was Michael Jackson, the late Michael Jackson, when he was alive. I was in my earlier stage of my business, came to me and wanted to design a family crest. Never designed a family crest before, but he wanted to make a pendant of his family crest. So I had gone to Neverland Ranch and sat with him many, many times to kind of go through different drawings and ideas for a family crest that embodied the story of the Jackson family. And we finally got to one after countless visits and countless appointments with him. And we finally got to one, and we ended up making about 10 pendants that he actually used on the doorways of his home, in the hallway, just as a decoration, if you will, for the house, all made of diamonds and gold. But if anyone can do it, Michael Jackson can do it.
Yeah, that's right. He can get away with diamonds crusted in front of your door.
Yeah. No one else can, but he can do it.
No one else can. And I imagine there's, you know, it was insane looking. Let me ask you this. When you, being at the draft, being here at the NFL draft, how important is it to you to be here for your business?
First and foremost, I'm a sports fan as well. So, like, I really, truly enjoy sports. So, for me to get a chance to rub shoulders with executives, players, agents, I mean, that's a dream come true for me. So, I really, truly enjoy it. And like I said, I always go towards things I enjoy. Because when you go towards things you enjoy, you do really well at them. Because there's passion behind it. And it's important for me to show my face. It's important for me to shake hands with the agents, the team officials, the incoming players. Because if you're not seen, then people just forget about you. So it is important that I maintain our roots, because this is how I started, and this is something I'm always going to do. I don't care how big the business gets. It's something I enjoy.
You enjoy the personal interaction, the face-to-face is what you're saying?
I really enjoy the face-to-face, the personal interaction, the close ties I have in the sports community. I mean, we were fortunate enough to do five championship rings in the last 9 years. Warriors, we did the Lakers twice, Warriors twice, and we just did the Dodger rings for the LA Dodgers. So I really enjoy that part of the business. It's like, listen, I wasn't the most athletic kid, so this is like the next closest thing I can do to being in sports.
To being in sports.
Yeah.
Oh, I love that. If you look at your business, and I want to just let everyone know that, you know, I know people are going to finish this and they're going to Google you, and they're, you know, those that haven't heard, they're going to, you know, end up at your YouTube channel and check you out, and they're going to realize that you are mega. I mean, you just exploded in this business, coming in just starting in 2002. So it's never too, you know, to entrepreneurs out there thinking, well, you know, I missed the boat for something or I have an idea. No, you start and you run with it. So I'm really humbled that you're, you know, that you're talking to me, but also just your attitude about it. You're passionate and you're enthusiastic about, you know, your business. What would you say, looking back, if you could give advice to someone watching that is thinking about developing a brand, changing an industry, because your industry, you know, is always kind of this one-dimensional jewelry concept. Yes, to the celebrity, they might have had access to certain things that you've allowed now and brought to globally through your stores, that people come in and have this interaction with jewelry pieces and through your creativity. So you kind of changed it and added some dimensions to it that I think that didn't exist to the general public. So what advice would you give to those starting out or thinking about going into a venture that they've dreamt of, that is probably something that's, you know, one-dimensional, but they're thinking about blowing it up. And advice that you wish someone would have shared with you?
Well, I mean, I would say that the most important aspects to really scaling your business is, especially in the beginning, right, is, like I said, find something you're passionate about, never take no for an answer, and always find your niche. Like, what is the niche? What is your, who are you going to serve, and why? Why is there a need for the product or service that you're selling?
Right.
Because you have to understand the need in order to properly to fulfill it. You have to understand the need, and I think that is something that is really, really, really important. Really, really important. And then I would say, as far as scaling your business, it is. I can't stress how important it is to always take the time to look at your business from a macro level. Meaning, sometimes you have to take a day away from the office because you can't see the forest for the trees. And you have to look at a bird's eye view of your business and understanding what is your plan, not next week, not tomorrow, but 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 25 years from now. And when you're able to identify those long-term goals, it'll make the pathway so much easier. And I feel like that when I started my company, there was a point where I couldn't see the forest for the trees. Fires that show up every single day in the office, problems with a client, problems with the manufacturing, like any other business. But it's important to solve those short-term things, but not at the expense of diverting your attention from the long-term goal. And I think that that is the most important thing, is always take the time to look at your business from a macro level and identify what your goals are 5, 10, 15, and 25 years down the road, and keep revisiting it. Those goals might change from year to year, but it's important to have it written down, posted up in your wall, something that reminds you of what, why you wake up in the morning and what you're trying to accomplish.
Oh my goodness, I could be here for the rest of the day, but I know you got some players to meet. Thank you so much.
My pleasure, thank you for having me.
Stay connected.
For sure.
Please. And I know that some of my clients already enjoy your pieces and are already clients of yours. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you.